Ann Coulter, how you doing?
Fine, thanks. Are you all buttoned down for the storm, Mark Simone?
Where are you? You're not in New York, right?
No, I'm in by a sunny beach.
Well, I hope there's a big tidal wave comes by. A sunny beach. I hope it's filled with man o' war. How do you like that?
Actually, I'm sorry I'm missing the storm. I love winter storms because, of course, I don't have a job, so I can stay home and watch it.
Yeah, that's true. So far, it's okay. It's going to get messy later today. Hey, Gary Cohn leaving. I'm watching MSNBC. Chaos in the White House. I think this is great for the White House. This is chaos with the globalists.
Of course. I mean, unfortunately, it reminds me of one of the things I'm mad at your president for, which is hiring all these Goldman Sachs people to begin with. I described this actually on a segment on Hannity, but he cut it, so I had to put it in a column. Gary Cohn was the man, one of probably the top five most responsible for the housing crash that destroyed the economy. He ran Goldman Sachs' housing department while they were, on one hand, they believed that the housing market was going to crash, so they're shorting it. Meanwhile, they're telling partners, their clients, oh, no, it's great, it's fine, buy, which works fine, I mean, if you have no morals or ethics, unless your trading partner gets bankrupted, and that's what happened to AIG. They were on the other side of these deals. They were betting that the housing market wouldn't crash. Goldman Sachs, under the great management of Gary Cohn, was betting very heavily that it would crash. When it did, AIG couldn't pay them back. So why is Gary Cohn and the rest of Goldman Sachs multimillionaires? Ah, that's where you come in, taxpayer. Because of that massive bailout to AIG so that they could pay back Goldman Sachs.
Yeah.
That's how this rich guy made money. So Trump's line defending Gary Cohn by, oh, I never got a job from a poor man. I want him to do for the economy what he did at Goldman Sachs. Well, what he did at Goldman Sachs, it doesn't translate. You rip off your trading partners. You lie to your clients. And by the way, this is all covered. I didn't have to do the heavy research. There was a one-year Senate report on this. You can read it. It's like a 200-page report run by both Republicans and Democrats signing off on it. That's the guy that longtime liberal Democrat that Donald Trump brought into the White House. He's opposed to the entire Trump agenda. He would be the first one on the TV show I told you, the one TV show I want to have, with exactly one episode where I invite people from the Trump White House onto my show, hook them up to a polygraph and ask them, did you vote for Donald Trump? So, yeah, I couldn't be happier that he's gone now. Of course he's against the wall. He's against trade. And it also reminds me, okay, yes, he's finally doing it. Maybe someday, maybe by the third Christmas of Trump's administration, he'll start the single promise, most important promise of his campaign to build a wall. But the three crucial issues to Donald Trump, which is why it doesn't matter what he does, it doesn't matter any of the allegations, it doesn't matter the divorces, affairs, the alleged but not true P-word grabbing, none of that matters because for the first time, well, I guess ever, voters were allowed to vote for a set of issues that neither the Republican Party nor the Democratic Party would offer them. And the three issues are immigration, deport illegals and build a wall, immigration, trade, stop shipping jobs abroad, and no more pointless wars. Well, it was 420 days into the Trump administration before he began to fulfill any one of those promises.
Well, he got the tax plan done, and listen,
that was not a promise.
Well,
every Republican offers that. That's the same as Jeb exclamation point. What happened to Jeb exclamation point? He got two electoral votes. This wasn't about tax cuts. It wasn't about moving the embassy to Jerusalem or wherever. That's not what Donald Trump ran on. That's not the kryptonite he holds that protects him from the media and the Democrats. And unless he gets back to the issues that are his kryptonite, I mean, in this case, I guess the media and the Republicans and the Democrats in the swamp are Superman, so maybe kryptonite isn't the right word. It is his coat of armor. The collection of these three issues, immigration, trade, no more pointless wars, no more adventurism abroad.
Well, there are no more pointless wars. You'll get your wall. And trade, he's already making progress. But no president...
I love him on trade.
No president has ever faced this much opposition, even from his own party.
No, of course, because of all these free trade fanatics. Oh, incidentally, I'll talk about trade specifically in a second. But the last candidate for office who came close to this collection of issues, which I keep saying, I think the voters understand this. If only we could get Trump to understand Trumpism, was Ross Perot. And Ross Perot, odd-looking little fellow, funny voice, some wacky conspiracy theories. He almost beat George Bush. He almost beat Bill Clinton. He was polling ahead of them, both of them, until he dropped out because he claimed the CIA had disrupted his daughter's wedding.
Yeah, well, actually, he probably could have won that thing, but people close to him say deep down he didn't really want to win.
You know, that's what they say about Trump. I don't know what happened, but the point is, those are the issues. It's not that Trump was a reality TV star. He couldn't be more different from Ross Perot. It's the issues. Any politician, why can't they figure this out in the swamp? Why doesn't every politician see, oh my gosh, if I take this collection of issues, I can do anything. I could be president of the United States. And as for the trade thing, no, he's been great. And of course he's right. I mean, I was noticing the craziness of the media saying, he says trade wars are easy to win. What he's saying, as he explained and as Wilbur Ross has clearly explained, when you're getting your butt kicked in a trade war or in anything, you're not the one who's going to call the game off. You're not going to have China and other countries saying, okay, you're putting a tariff on our goods. That's it. We're not trading with you. It would be as if you're in the ninth inning of a baseball game and you're the team that's 20 runs ahead. It starts to rain. Are you going to say, okay, that's it, let's call this game for rain?
Yeah. So.
No. You start buying American goods. You stop making it difficult for Americans to sell their goods abroad. I think this is really fantastic. I also really, really liked Wilbur Ross's point. That was very clever of him, holding up the Campbell soup can, because the claim by the free trade absolutists it'll increase the price of steel, and that will hurt all these other industries. Prices will go up, the economy will collapse. And he holds up the Campbell soup can and says, this costs $1.99. The amount of steel in this can costs 3 cents.
Yeah.
No, it's not going to bankrupt the economy.
The increase will be a third of a penny.
Yeah, and I think it's also worth pointing out here, this is finally the first policy. Of course, Gary Cohn resigns over this. Who makes money off rotten trade deals that destroy jobs for ordinary working class Americans? Wall Street does, because they get to formulate all the trade agreements and appear before the trade councils. And they have lots of busy work because they don't produce anything except money.
Well, Ann Coulter, I hate to say we're out of time, but if you want to read a great book, get In Trump We Trust, and get her book, Adios America. And when is the new column comes out tonight, right?
It comes out tonight, another BAFO column, and you can also go home in the snow and read Adios America.
Well,
good day to stay home from work.
Yeah, actually, just go to anncoulter.com. You can get everything there. Oh, and follow Ann Coulter on Twitter. And thanks for being with us.
Good to talk to you, Mark Simone. Bye-bye.
Take care.